So I'm Julian Vasquez Heilig. I am the director of the Doctorate in Educational Leadership and a professor of Educational Leadership and Policy Studies here at California State Sacramento. So glad you folks braved the cold. What is it, 50 degrees out there today? So we're so glad that you're here. The authors actually asked me to say a little bit about the migrant roots in my own family. My family was from Texas Tejas. They were Tejanos, and they lived there. My grandmother would always say, the border crossed them, they didn't cross the border. That was their ancestral land. And one branch of the Vasquez family went north to Sacramento, California, believe it or not, many, many decades ago. The other branch of the family went north to Pick in Michigan, specifically Saginaw. They picked sugar beets and cherries and cucumbers. And I was actually inspired by the lunch that we had with the authors today to contact my family, because I remember many years ago in a UFW AFL-CIO brochure, my mother just happened across a photograph of my grandfather with a basket of cherries. And so while we were at lunch, I texted my family and I said, I remember this photograph from when I was a young person. Do we have it? And my tia sent it to me. And so now I have it in perpetuity and it's uploaded to the cloud, I guess, right? And I showed that to the author. So I'm just so excited and let me tell you one more quick story, because this is really about access to higher education, right? My mother grew up doing migrant work in the early part of her life until my grandfather got a job in the General Motors auto factories. Well, the migrant, at the time, the University of Michigan had a recruiter for migrant students. And I didn't tell you this part of the story. I just found this out in the strangest way. I was talking to a professor from the University of Texas at San Antonio. And he had told me he had used to recruit for the University of Michigan, and it turned out that that professor was the person who had recruited my uncle to go to the University of Michigan, who then had taught my mother how to apply to college and what she needed to do to be successful in college. And then, of course, later, I also graduated from the University of Michigan. So that's a little piece of the story I didn't tell you. So that's just a quick background on my own family history. And so we're just so excited today to have Gloria Cuadras, Yolanda Flores, Manuel Barajas, and also Dr. our own EDD professor, Dr. Caroline Turner, to talk about this really fantastic book, Claiming Home, Shaping Community, Testimonios de los Valles. And I also would like to say, that this is a presentation that is being broadcast live right now on Facebook. So hello to all of you out there on the internet, and then also being taped in perpetuity for YouTube. And so we're just so glad again to make this commitment to this very important work. And without further ado, we'll bring up the authors. Thank you.
Thank you. Can you hear me? It's our pleasure to be here, and we would like to thank CSU Sacramento's Doctorate in Educational Leadership for inviting us to share our work with you today. We would especially like to thank Professor Caroline Turner, who has been a long lifetime mentor to me. And so thank you for both contributing to the book and to being here with us today and making sure that this took place. We would also like to thank the director, Julian Vasquez Heilig, for supporting our visit, and Tina Weekly for all the arrangements and communications, Christy Garrett, and for the wonderful graduate students that we met over lunch. Thank you. We'd like to begin our presentation today by Dr. Flores and I will read from our introduction. We'll both read from it and share some talking points with you. And we're going to present some of the PowerPoint here as we speak, and we will be followed by Dr. Barajas and Dr. Turner, who will do readings from their testimonios, and then we will open it up for questions, okay? Esther Hernandez, a visual artist from the small farming town of Dinuba in California's San Joaquin Valley, remembers her counselor's response to her desire to study art in college. Quote, "When I graduated from high school in 1962, the school counselor laughed when I told her I wanted to be a professional artist and said there was no need for an artist in a farming community. She said that my best chance to use my art was to try to get a job drawing facial composites of people of color that the police were looking for, people of color. This was not acceptable to me or my family, so I began dreaming about moving away from the San Joaquin Valley," unquote. In 1968, Jose Padilla, who was graduating as valedictorian of his hometown high school in Brawley, California, was whisked aside by his grandmother, who advised him, "As the cactus is common, you come from common folk, from working people who work for a living, sweat to feed their children, sweat to survive, and ask for nothing not merited. Never forget your root, common people, and common workers."
In the late 1970s, Nani Alejandres was enrolled in the community studies program at UC Santa Cruz, where he pondered on the empowerment of his community studies. Being from a family of farm workers, I had watched a seed turn into a blossom, then turn into food to nourish the body. The community studies program reminded me that I was that seed. Young people who grow up in concrete jungles are never able to see that concept develop because it is too hard to come from the concrete. I consider myself blessed to be able to recognize the power of a single seed. Today, Esther Hernandez is an internationally recognized artist whose work is included in the permanent collections of the Smithsonian's Art Institute collection. Jose Padilla serves as the executive director of the California Rural Legal Assistance Program, an organization dedicated to advocating for the rights of California's farm workers. Nani Alejandres is a founder and chair of the National Coalition of Barrios Unidos, a nonprofit anti-violence organization that has chapters in 30 cities across the United States.
Some of the contributors to our book share in common their Mexican ancestry, their working class origins, and their roots in California's agricultural valleys, and the accomplishment of having earned degrees from the University of California system. Their educational journeys illustrate the transformative power of education, one that transcends the individual and serves our community. Yet, in the second decade of the 21st century, from the consequences of global restructuring to the state's defunding of public higher education, to the tuition increases and exorbitant costs of a college education, and the continuing legal and political battles over affirmative action, we found ourselves, asking ourselves, would these individuals and those in similar conditions be able to attend a major public research university today? So this anthology features testimonials by people of Mexican descent who left rural agricultural valleys, specifically the Imperial Valley and the San Joaquin Valley, to pursue higher education at a UC campus. And both valleys, since the early 20th century, have been among the richest agricultural producing regions in the US, and both valleys are distant from urban centers where power and influence reside. And since the beginning of the 20th century, historical documents, evidence how politicians spoke of people of Mexican descent as their preferred labor force for the agribusiness sector of the state's economy. Yet the discussion of people of Mexican descent into higher education is acknowledged really only after the early years of the Chicano Civil Rights Movement in the history of the University of California. To date, Mexican American residents of the most rural and isolated towns of these valleys live in extreme forms of isolation and neglect. And while symbolically the contributors' journeys embody the master narrative of the American dream, our purpose in claiming home is not to reify these trajectories, not to echo the rags to riches trope that we've all become so accustomed to, right? But rather to assert within the national conversation the need to reconsider how we understand the purpose and heart of education, to reconnect with the meaning and infinite possibilities that partaking in higher education may have, not only for individuals, but for the well-being of our social fabric. The contributors respond to the crisis in higher education, and they bear witness to how their access to a UC education opened avenues, career paths, and lifelong commitments that they might not have otherwise considered. Access to a quality research, to quality education, to researchers and to knowledge producers, position thousands of people of Mexican descent who have earned their degrees from a University of California campus to shape and contribute to the public good. And these are some pictures from both the Imperial Valley and the San Joaquin Valley.
We write with a sense of ethical urgency based on the premise that access to public higher education, public research universities for working class communities is at stake. We recognize that this is not a new dilemma. Nationally, access to select public research universities for historically disenfranchised communities has long been the case. While recent discussions on the affordability of higher education have centered on the American middle class, the extent to which students from the working class are being affected remains in dire need of attention.
So our anthology is unique in that it includes writings both by individuals who became academics and non-academics, people outside academia, that represent a broad spectrum of involvement in law, arts, nonprofits, social service, and educational institutions. Most comparable anthologies include only the voice and lived experiences of academics, and I'm sure many of you here are familiar with some of those works. So our anthology features both, and as such, I think is a testament to the academic community linkage that has been so critical to the formation of fields such as Chicano and Chicana studies. Though migrant, agricultural, and rural student experiences are documented in education and sociological scholarship, there are currently no voices that center the voices, lives, challenges, and successes of the residents of California's agricultural bias in higher education. So the unique historical and contemporary challenges of these agricultural spaces are often lost in the narrative of California. And as educational disparities persist, it is critical to these testimonials that these testimonials be shared to provide models of paths towards success. And while there have been several educational memoirs by Chicanos and Chicanas since the early 1980s, sort of we contend there is a need to consider the relationship of place to educational trajectories. That the rich history of the San Joaquin and Imperial Valleys in California situate these testimonials in the context of connections between the Chicano population and agricultural labor, public policy, migration, and access to higher education.
We center on these two agricultural valleys because a key component of California's economy for most of the 20th century has been the agribusiness economy. Politically and demographically, as members of North America's largest ethnic group, we recognize that raising the educational attainment levels for Americans of Mexican descent is imperative for national economic and social solvency. Mexican American representation in the UC's distinctive mission to produce knowledge workers and to generate research is critical for the formation of our leadership sector, allowing socioeconomic mobility and the transformation of communities and regions. The contributors testify that in respect to their individual lives, they embody the purpose that the University of California was mandated to serve in the 1960s California Master Plan, which I think many of you know that was this master plan was one that was followed by other major research public universities like University of Texas, University of Michigan. For those from families from rural areas not historically well reserved by the public education system in California, the opportunity to obtain a college education in one of the top tier campuses of the University of California was significant, not only for their individual lives and opportunities, but also for what it represented to their families, their hopes and aspirations, their sacrifices, and to the advancement of our communities. Even though people of Latino descent in California in 2014 constitute approximately 39% of the state's population, of this Latino population, 83% of our Mexican descent, the representation of Chicanos at the University of California has yet to achieve parity with the state's Chicano population. In 2015, Latinos comprised 22% of students enrolled in the University of California system, 35% of the California State University system, and 40% of students enrolled in California community system. Especially notable is that two-thirds of Latinos in California began their higher education at the community college system, and that they are most likely to remain in California to pursue higher education. By way of example, Latinos comprise 28% of the 97,600 transfer students in California, who in 2015, 63% of Latino students transferred to a California State campus, while 12% transferred to a UC campus. Thus, each of the public higher education entities play a critically essential role in the higher education of the state's Latino population.
So theoretically, I am from the Imperial Valley, from a small town of Raleigh, and Yolanda is from Bakersfield.
In the Salt Lake Valley.
And so, so when we're thinking about our framework, we decided that theoretically the testimonios of the individuals whose educational trajectories are encapsulated in the anthology would speak to home, right? How the processes, memories, and sentimientos about home as a place, whether living in it, returning to it, physically or metaphorically, shape their identities, lives, and lifelong commitments. These testimonials contribute to the rich body of Chicano literature, exemplified in memoir, autobiographical works, and testimonial writings. And collectively, the essays echo themes and theorizations found in scholarly literature about home, place, and landscapes. Yen Espíritu, for example, suggests that, quote, home is both an imagined and actual geography, unquote, and is both connected to and disconnected from the physical space in which one lives. And central to the contributors' narratives and ours are the family histories and processes of migration, both transnationally and internally.
Yeah, next one. So we bring to this conversation our desire to see plays and the interstices as central to our understanding of Latino educational achievement. Our interest in plays heeds the call of historians Vicky Ruiz and John Chavez, who write of ethno-regional identity as the fusion of landscape, historical memory, and lived experience. Furthermore, ethno-regional identities become manifest in part by culture, tradition, kin, and community bonds, and gender in everyday. Among others, the essays and the volume by Esther Hernandez and John Alcon illustrate that ethno-regional identities are formed within the intra-ethnic, intercultural, multiracial, and Anglo context. It is never an identity constructed solely on the Mexican and European American spheres. The processes of leaving home, moving to a city, attending at least elite research universities will continue to necessitate further negotiations of these ethno-regional identities. Ethno-regionalist identities are deeply embedded in our contributors' testimonials, illustrating not only the importance of ethno-regional identity in the development of the author's professional commitments, but also in how members of an economically and racially marginalized group, when connected with the far-reaching power of higher education, can work on behalf of the public good.
And we drew upon the genre of testimonio because of its potency, because its potency is about the claiming of lived experience. In staking this claim, those who testify bear witness to the dehumanizing processes to which their communities have been or are subject. Testimonio is inherently political, right? A vehicle to counter hegemony of the state and to illuminate the repression and denial of human rights. From a methodological standpoint, Delgado Bernal, Burciaga, and Carmona remind us that testimonio is both a product and a process. Pedagogically, testimonio becomes a vehicle by which teaching and learning of lived experiences can take place. Testimonio allows for a more holistic and humane approach, and one that can integrate mind, body, and spirituality. And like Paulo Freire's concept of conscienticidad, testimonio allows for a critical consciousness to take root and connects the everyday experiences to the larger structural and often contradictory forces. Hence, the narrators and writers of our collection of testimonios become both the knowledge producers and translators of their own experience. Scholarly works on pedagogies of home, again, Delgado Bernal's work comes to mind, speaks to the ways in which funds of knowledge, such as that articulated by Carlos Vélez Ibáñez and James Greenberg, embodied knowledge and lived experience garnered from our families and communities of origin intersect to shape and define our trajectories as we navigate through higher education and onto our respective career paths, commitments, and vocations.
In this collection, we define embodied knowledge to name the familial, cultural, historical, political, and linguistic assets that some of the contributors note in their chapters. The testimonios illustrate how knowledge from home and family may serve as foundational to their educational journeys. Critical pedagogies direct us to appreciate how teachings that take place in the home, in addition to more formal mentoring relationships in university settings, led to larger commitments for social justice. Some contributors pursued a college education with an understanding of the familial and ancestral cultural knowledge they carried within themselves. Jose Padilla's testimonio offers a broader and more democratic understanding of teachers and of learning. He writes, "Many years ago, I was taught that teaching and learning come in many flavors, that you are taught by teachers who have no title or degree or even schooling themselves. early in my young adulthood, I learned that I learned first from women early lessons that contributed to my success in school and to the choice of pursuing the practice of law. On the other hand, in John Alcon's essay, we engage his father's definition of bien educado, well educated, which is meant being respectful of others regardless of their class, social, economic, legal, or educational status. Thus offering a counter definition of what is commonly viewed as bien educado. The paternal saying of Rosa Jiménez's "A nuestro camino es más largo" and of Gloria Cuadra's "Hay que seguir adelante" embody beliefs whose authors carried through their academic trajectories and beyond. While for me, the familial oral tradition of my ancestors made me keenly aware of how incomplete, even at the most prestigious and rigorous universities, formal higher education was in respect to the presence and contributions of Mexican Americans in this country. The academic literature in education has established the critical role of mentoring in higher education settings. Certainly many, although not all, the contributors allude to the critical importance that individual mentors at the university had in shaping their transitions, direction, and the journey of their career choices. Caroline Turner captures the prominent role that multiple mentors played throughout her entire undergraduate and graduate work. Regardless of mentor's position at the university, finding and connecting with someone who functioned as a mentor proved invaluable to many of the contributors' transitions, adjustments, and successes in the educational journeys. These connections at the university often resonated with the homegrown forms of mentorship and support. Caroline Turner was inspired to view mentoring as an integral component of her professional standing as a professor, a scholar, and a mentor. Indeed, it became her way of paying forward the mentorship she received from her home, community, and university mentors.
So many contributors also wrote about the benefits of the programs designed by the university to help first-generation low-income students. In their chapters, other contributors acknowledged how these services enhanced their ability to succeed in college, fortifying the foundation for their academic success and future careers. These conclusions concur with researchers who have found that university-based political participation has a lasting impact on the creation of activist identities and political orientations that may last a lifetime. And in some cases, the conditions of home and their parents' struggles were foundational in shaping contributors' worldviews and awareness of social issues. Esther Hernandez and Yolanda Flores, for example, grew up with parents involved in social justice struggles and union organizing, which set the stage for their lifetime commitments. Imbued throughout the chapters, contributors such as Frank Galarte spoke of the critical importance of taking courses in Chicano and ethnic studies, meant for his ability to come away with a more refined sense of empowerment and belonging, and shape the direction of his own intellectual journey into the professoriate. These are the immeasurable outcomes that we can ill afford to ignore. For Enid Perez, upon completion of her law degree and her return home to the San Joaquin Valley, and witnessing the poverty and the environmental racism in her hometown, she launched into the center of a controversy when she attempted to challenge an unhealthy environmental health hazard. And John Halcón became a scholar in race and multicultural education and a faculty union activist in the state of California and beyond. And Manuel Barajas is a scholar of transnational Mexican migrant communities in the California agricultural landscape, which pays homage to his own upbringing in Stockton. The examples are infinite.
While at the individual level, these testimonials support the notion that the educational system is meritocratic. These stories more powerfully suggest how the opening and increasing of access in the myriad of ways in which this is accomplished unleashes and creates the very conditions necessary for human potential to be actualized. It impressively suggests that an educational system that expands the definition of what constitutes quality and a system that diversifies who is situated to make such determination has the potential to achieve far greater outcomes. Does not a system mandated to accept the best and the brightest also has a responsibility to expand their definition of what constitutes the best? When individuals are provided opportunities they would otherwise not have been privy to, the unleashed growth and the actualization of the potential may result in a societal impact far greater than one might have expected. These testimonials exemplify the culture of possibility and tell us what numbers cannot always predict. In conclusion, these testimonials reminds us of the remarkable human potential and talent that individuals from agricultural valleys possess. While specific to the regions of the Imperial and the San Joaquin Valleys, these essays illuminate the long-term societal benefits of federal legislation and resources for public higher education, adequately state-funded higher education, and a need to continue with policies that broaden access and resources for the marginalized sectors of society. Contributor Nani Alejandres uses the metaphor of the seed to highlight the transformative power of education. In this spirit, we offer these testimonials as seedlings of human potential that must be cultivated. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And with that, we're going to invite, first Dr. Manuel Barajas to do a small reading from his testimonial, and then Dr. Caroline Turner. Thank you.
Gracias, thank you. First of all, I want to thank Gloria, Yolanda, for inviting me to contribute to this, to their amazing book, and to Caroline Turner for connecting me with them. Gracias. My name is Manuel Barajas. I grew up in Stockton. I'm a third generation migrant, meaning that my grandparents migrated, worked here in the US, followed by my parents in the 50s, my mom in the late 60s, and then we came as a third generation group of kids, babies, children, and were thrown into the San Joaquin Valley, San Joaquin County fields. And so the experiences of growing up in the fields greatly shaped my interest in migration and exploitation and educational equity. And so in my chapter that I'm contributing to this book, I have several themes that I highlight, and that's growing up in the fields, growing up in the housing projects, and the third part is being a first generation college student. And I'm gonna focus on the last one because it relates to our students here. So aquí les va, here it goes. And it's the heading is titled, I'm getting old, I need my glasses. So the heading is The Politics of Nativism in Higher Education. We need lighting in here. Like most of the Chicano students I went to college with, and like those who now enroll in my classes. Oh, thank you. Like most of the Chicano students I went to college with, and like those who now enroll in my classes, I was the first in my family to attend and graduate from college. That I went straight to a four-year university was largely luck, not a consequence of my individual exceptionality. My siblings, friends, and I shared similar levels of intelligence, discipline, motivation, language, and culture, and social connections. None of us had ties with college-educated or professional people. And going to college was largely accidental for me, though contextual structures of opportunity helped make it possible. That I managed to get into college preparatory courses immediately upon entering high school, and that I was encouraged by a counselor to go to college were occurrences of luck. When I was in eighth grade, an older brother invited me to study for some tests that needed to be passed to graduate from high school. This invitation to do math and read comprehension exercises for a few weekends prepared me to pass the exams given to me in the eighth grade, placing me in college prep classes in high school. I was fortunate also that while I was in middle and high school, government mandated busing for racial integration opened the doors to public schools with more resources than middle-class white schools. Even then, the concept of college was foreign to me, and I had no plans of going to the university. But luck happened again. At the beginning of my senior year, a very nice counselor, Ms. X, inquired about my plans after graduation. She asked, quote, "So Manuel, what are you gonna do with your life after you finish high school?" End of quote. Having no ideas, I replied what seemed realistic to me, quote, "I might join the Marines like my older brother, Jorge," end of quote. Ms. X immediately suggested that college was a good option for me considering my GPA and coursework. She then invited me to a workshop with students who were part of a college-bound program and were benefiting from outreach counselors from regional colleges. In one such workshop, a counselor helped me fill out an application and a fellow student assisted me with my statement of purpose. Spring came along, I crossed paths with Mrs. X again, and she immediately asked about my plans. I shared with her that I had applied to two schools and both had accepted me, and that I would be going to UC Davis. Mrs. X's face changed from one of delight to one of concern. She said, quote, "I'm afraid that school is too big for you and that you might get lost and drop out if you get a girl pregnant. You should consider a community college first," end of quote. I did not know what to say and felt somewhat discouraged. But by that time, I had also gained confidence being in classes with children of the privileged whose professional parents worked as professors, lawyers, doctors, administrators, and I knew that I had no less ability than any of them, and that I was often at the top of my class. Such low expectations, as expressed by Ms. X for working class minority students, do not come from nowhere, but reflect historical trends and powerful racial gender stereotypes, creating and justifying the low academic achievement of Chicanas and Chicanos. The barriers that limit minority and low-income families' access to quality in higher education are not accidental, but reflect unfair structures of opportunity in our society. Why should I be critical about inequalities in the US, considering that as a first-generation college graduate and now a university professor, I have experienced substantial mobility from the agricultural fields to the academic ones? On the surface, it appears that my personal accomplishments validate the American dream, that anyone with discipline, work ethic, and some intelligence can make it in this country. Adopting this individualist view of personal success and resilience would probably make me look better to some, but I would not feel honest or feel good with such a line, knowing well all my relationships in community. I know that it was not the best students who graduate from high school and pursue higher education. If that were the case, many of my siblings and good friends with much ability and discipline would have gone off to college as well. Simplifying achievement to individual characteristics distorts the consequential weight of unequal structures of opportunity that privilege some and disadvantage many others. In low-income and racially segregated communities, for instance, one out of 10 may go to college, with most attending community college. Across town in the middle-class, upper-class white communities, the great majority of high school students go straight to four-year universities. These differences cannot be explained by considering only individual characteristics or by weighing some more than others. If it were so simple, racial and class patterns in college success would disappear, and racial stereotypes and expectations as expressed by Ms. X above would not exist. Some people nonetheless contend that some racial minorities and working class families do not have a culture that values education as much as European or Asian Americans or the economic middle and upper classes. In their view, brown and black people neither value education nor have the merits and motivation for academic success. The obvious racist, class bias, and non-empirical flaws aside, this argument neglects the internal diversity within those racial categories of class, gender, ethnicity, and culture, generation, nationality, and others, and the history of institutional bias against underrepresented racial minorities. Higher education, from the minority experience and perspective, remains very discriminatory and exclusionary. And those who make it to college are forced to accommodate to disparate learning opportunities, biased standards, and hostile environments that lower their GPAs and graduation rates. And I think I'm gonna stop there and focus that I went to school, to college, I started college 30 years ago, and I'm a full-time professor, and the trends haven't improved. When I started here as a full-time professor, there were 12 Latinos in my college of the social sciences. Now I'm the only one, the only brown, Chicano, indigenous person. And this is unacceptable in these times. So we need to take knowledge into informing action. Y con eso nos dejo. Gracias.
The year was 1963, and I was excited to leave the labor camp, looking forward to doing something besides going to school in Hollister or working in the field. The housing provided by the farm owner consisted of corrugated steel shacks that were like barracks for both single laborers and families. We were fortunate because my stepfather took on added responsibilities, so we lived in a standalone corrugated steel building with two bedrooms, a living room, a kitchen, and a bathroom. Our family of 10 lived there. We had no phone or air conditioning. I remember heating the water on the stove and waiting my turn when we took baths. Although many would now think this was horrible, we were happy to have hot water. Played a lot as we determined who would be first in the clean bath water. We would also have to determine who would sleep at the feet when there were three of us sharing a bed. Tomato fields surrounded our house. A long dirt road led to the highway where we caught the school bus in the morning. In the distance were the Gavilan Mountains. I remember thinking as I walked to the bus stop how beautiful and far away they were. My stepfather planted a vegetable garden in the back. He loved his bitter melons and eggplant. It was a simple and quiet existence, punctuated day and night during the growing season with the sounds of crop duster planes and the whirring of the sprinklers. It was hard to sleep through the sound of the sprinklers so close to our building. I recently lost two siblings to cancer, and my mother and I are cancer survivors. When my family remembers the crop dusters, we wonder if this contributed to the high incidence of cancer in our family. When I left for college, I could not understand my mother's hesitancy. Instead of seeing her actions as barriers to my continued education, I now realize that ultimately, hers were the actions of a very courageous and self-sacrificing woman. Knowing I would never return, she let me go. She left me in a strange town, Davis, California, knowing nothing about what I was going to experience. However, I believe she knew then what I did not, that I would never return home. Now, I wish I lived closer to my family, but we never lost our close connection. But at the time, I was excited to get away and do something different. While I was in Hollister, I always felt out of place. I didn't fit in with the people I knew. As the only one from the labor camps, I felt alone in my college prep classes, and I was not interested in cruising or writing graffiti on bathroom walls. I loved dancing, but was not allowed to do anything after school except come home. Even though I knew nothing about college life, I looked forward to encountering new experiences in hopes of finding a place where I fit. But college was another place where I felt out of place. At this moment, thinking back, I realized my mother was the brave one, not me. She always supported my education, and in spite of the pain she must have experienced when I left, a major transition for her, she let her firstborn move away from home. I am the oldest in my family with 8 younger siblings. My brother Junior once told me that when I left home, he did not understand why I had to leave. When I went to the university, I missed Hollister and my family. At home, I believe a major reason we did not starve or become homeless during hard times was that our community pooled resources, whether it was food or money, to help one another. I remember families coming to our house with vegetables and fruits grown in the region where they lived, and we would exchange our fruits and vegetables for theirs. Families would purchase and slaughter livestock together and share the meat. In college, competition rather than community was stressed. I did not know that leaving home for me was to enter an alien place called the University of California, Davis. I remember on the first day of student orientation, we in the audience were asked to look to our right and to our left and told that only one of us would remain at the end of the year. I felt out of place, but also hoped that I would be able to stay. It was the early 1960s, so songs by the Beatles were blaring from every dorm room window. Farm labor movement was brewing, and the civil rights movement was underway. Thank you.
So I think if you would like, we can open it up for questions, or we can read from a couple more testimonials. Yes.
I was interested in some of the theories that they were putting forth about the troubles that you know, Latinos would have, you know, coming from their original environment and coming into college, and not just, you know, having the trouble of the college challenge, but also the, you know, self challenges as far as from the community.
Okay.
The question is, the theories that you guys put forth, do you think that those theories could potentially be applied, and he kind of touched about, you know, as far as being applied to black and brown, but even further demographic groups that have trouble accessing higher education, do you think that some of those things may also help explain the troubles those groups have as well?
Well, I think one of the things that we wanted to do was sort of not to essentialize, right, to the point where, I know on the literature on Chicanos and education, right? Initially, there was a myth that Latino parents didn't care about education, right? Or that we were destined for low educational achievement. So when we asked people to write their testimonios, we wanted to have the diversity of lived experiences. We wanted those individuals who came from homes from very adverse conditions, who wouldn't necessarily, let's say, you know, point to the supportive parental structure that they had, right, that facilitated their pathway. We wanted to hear the other stories as well, right, the other testimonials that spoke to individuals who came from families who had a difficult time in their homes, who wanted to escape working in the fields, right, that wanted to never return home. So in that sense, I think we honored that, because when you read through the essays, you'll find those who said, I'm sorry, there is no such thing as returning home, right? And then there are those who said, I return home, but these are the ways in which I return home. or I literally returned home, and this is the kind of work that I do. And the political work that people do is a big part of that, right? And in who they have dedicated working on behalf or advocating on behalf.
But going back to your question, my sense is that definitely that some of the theories that we, and when we talk about the need to expand access and services and knowledge and courses, I think that would definitely include to other forms of marginality within our societies and within our institutions. Definitely, I think that some of what we're saying applies to, you could, some of the theories that we used here could be useful to other marginalized groups as well, for sure, yeah.
But we did want to draw attention to those from the agricultural valleys because we felt it hadn't been done, right? I mean, I would go years without even meeting someone that was from the Imperial Valley, right? And I found myself at UC Santa Cruz after the community college, and at Berkeley, right, which is where we met. It was very rare to meet an individual from the Imperial Valley in my case. I think there were more from San Joaquin Valley, right?
Yeah, a little bit more. Going back to what Professor Baraja said, I just want to definitely concur with, and unfortunately, I wish this was different, but again, the reason we wanted to do this anthology, one of the main reasons is, again, asking ourselves, can people from these marginalized groups in the 21st century today, would they be able to go to a public research university? I can tell you that when I was at Berkeley as an undergrad, I paid $1,600 per year for tuition. Being a California resident, a California native, you know that the tuition nowadays is over $20,000 for California state student, I mean a California resident. And for somebody who I knew that my parents couldn't help me to with financially to go to school, I know that I probably would have not been I don't know if I would have had the courage to take a $100,000 loan just to go to college or to the UC campus as opposed to going to, and this is good too because Gloria and I started at a community college. She at the Imperial Valley and I at the Bakersfield College, both community colleges, and then we transferred to the UC system. So wanting to stress the notion or the unfortunate reality that there's still so much of need, just general, and then if we make it specific to the agricultural valleys, I think that the need to continue to be making those efforts to increase the access of higher education for Latinos of those communities is definitely much needed today. I don't know how many of you know of Delano, California, this little town where it was the birth of the United Farm Workers Union. I was there this summer. I'm from Bakersfield, so Delano is 30 miles away from Bakersfield, but I was there and they were doing a segment on this middle school music teacher who had retired and 40 years of teaching in Delano. The school had not replaced him, so he was now teaching for free, and this is a white Anglo-American guy. And the report started by saying that this community, 10% of the population of this community is in one of the state prisons. Do you know, I mean, that's just so devastating to think that 10% of this little town in, again, one of these smaller rural communities, that another factor, it's real. The state of California spends more money on the prison system in California than they do on higher education. So those are very, very concrete realities that contextualize what we wanted to address in this book, this anthology.
And in that initial report, the 1975 Chicanos in the University of California System Report, which was the first report of its kind, they made the comparison to the number of Latinos going to prisons versus higher education institutions. And I know that when I went from the community college to UC Santa Cruz, my father was quite older than my mother, and so he was already on Social Security. And it was very minimal because he had worked in agribusiness his entire life. And I remember actually sending back, because I was in college, I got a check for $88. And so to help my parents, right, I would send back those $88 in order for their, for them to be able, right, to make ends meet. But at that time, if one was eligible for financial aid, you were actually able to pay for your bills and pay for your livelihood on financial aid. At the end of 2 years at UC Santa Cruz, I actually owed $95. Okay. Today, I am supporting one of my nieces through my tuition waiver as a faculty member. And even with that 75% offset to the tuition, she is still going to owe $30,000 at the end of her higher education. Right. And so those were the kinds of conversations that we were having that sort of propelled us to begin to, you know, talk about the what we felt was certainly a lack of access to higher education that was occurring.
I just wanted to mention, I graduated with my bachelor's from Davis in 1967. So in the early 60s, there was no financial aid as we know it now. So I was fortunate that a mentor at the high school told me to apply for every scholarship that was out there. I found out what they were and helped me write the applications, and I got every single one of them. But the Cal Aggie Alumni Association scholarship, the people that were seated in front of me when they interviewed me for that scholarship, they realized the circumstances I came from, and they doubled the scholarship right then and there. So I didn't just get the regular scholarship, I got the double scholarship. So I was able to make it on that. And then when that ran out eventually, I was able to get a part-time job. But there was no way I could depend on anyone in my family or anyone else to help. Even though if I needed something and it was something that came up, my father would gather together the families in our community. And if there was a way for them to give me money or some access to resources, they would come up with it. So there was a lot of community then. I mean, I'm sure it still exists in many places, but that's what is the strength of our being able to move in difficult, very difficult times. So when I went to school, I think, there were scholarships, and that was about it. But I was also fortunate to get a job serving breakfast, lunch, and dinner at the dorms. So that was enough, and like both Gloria and Yolanda said, now it wouldn't be enough. That was enough for me to cover everything at the time.
I kind of forgot the question, but this is my question. How can we explain the sad trends that we see in our society with minorities? And I like to theorize. I think it's important to contextualize, to look at history. And I like to be comprehensive with the analysis, so I come from an intersectional framework, meaning that I don't reduce what happens to us just to one factor, to class, to race, to gender. I like to look at the various systems, how they impact our lives, our living conditions. Historically, it was very obvious. If you were of a specific racial background, if you were of a specific gender, nationality, class background, you would be denied housing, education. That changed in the 60s with the civil rights movements. And so one of the things that needs to be understood is when we talk about the Chicana-Chicano condition, we're essentially talking about the indigenous experience. There's tremendous diversity amongst us. The people who get the attention are those who come from the ranchos, the haciendas, the people who benefited from a history of dispossessing the indigenous people. Most of us come from the peasants. And so a lot of the history is told from that perspective. It's important to look at the internal diversity and to see why is it that certain racialized ethnicities, specifically brown people who are largely indigenous people, and African-Americans remain at the bottom. If we look at it historically, it makes sense. Just 100 years ago, exclusion was the norm, exclusion. And then later, 1896, is segregation, separate but equal, 1896. And in the 60s, that was challenged, and now it's sort of de facto. And there's what they call neoliberalism, which I call neocolonialism, which is sort of, oh, they don't get in because of their merits. Well, if we're working so much, how come we don't have the money to live in the places that we want to be able to access education? And so we gotta be critical. And we're not getting honesty from those who lead us. And so we have to, you know, we have to be, we have to step up and to tell it like it is based on empirical historical evidence. And so to theorize, we have to contextualize and to be comprehensive with our analysis. And that reduces to one factor. Gracias.
Did you have a question?
I was just going to ask concerning the challenges that you mentioned earlier in the 1960s, and it seems they are still here within today. So what's the solution? How are we going to work on overcoming all these challenges in order to change, since 50 or 60 years passed and everything is still the same?
Education is important, yeah. To create consciousness. But at a time when we need critical education to expand understandings, insights, critical understandings, there's a disinvestment in education. From the past 30, 40 years, there's been a reduction in fundings to higher education at a time when we needed more. And so we, you know, so I think for, we have to be active, we have to be collaborative, we have to. We have to act. We can't just like understand and teach. We have to make sure that our knowledge is getting placed in the right places to make pressure to inform actions, policies.
And maybe to decrease tuitions.
What is that?
Decrease tuition.
End tuitions. We have become more productive. We produce more wealth over the past 30 years, but most of us work more and we have less. 30, 40 years ago, there was the breadwinner, and their minimum wage could cover 85% of what they needed to get by in 1979. And like 2006, before the recession, it only covered like 65%. Minimum wage only covered 65% of what you needed to get by. That's before the recession. Things got really bad after the recession. Here at Sac State, we were reduced. Full-time faculty were reduced by one quarter. We were like 1,000 faculty, and now we're like 600, 700. And now we have more part-timers, lecturers, than full-time. When I started here 15 years ago, we had 70% of the faculty were full-time. Now we're 40%. So there's something bad. There's less security at work. And it's not just economics. It's racialized. It's gendered. The people who are more casualized are people of color and women.
And I would add to that response to your question that I think we need to strategically start organic efforts again. The institution has had several decades to develop these mechanisms that you can point to that we believe are supposed to be accomplishing these things. And when you read the literature from the 60s, there was an energy. There was an organic energy. There was an anger, a real connection to the social injustice. And people created, right? Organizations, they created movements with each other. They made connections and made alliances across racial ethnic groups. And too often now, I get a sense that there's sort of a glossiness, right? The university has offices that they can point to and commissions and organizations that they can point to that we believe is doing some of this work around diversity and increasing our representation. But I think sometimes we need to step outside of those institutionalized committees and structures and just connect with each other. What is really going on, right? What can we do? And what can we create that's new that might galvanize more resources or more possibilities for others? That would be my advice.
Thank you.
I just want to mention, for example, the state of New York. I teach at the University of Vermont, where, you know, New York State is our neighbor. I think it was last year that the Senate and the governor passed a law, and I think it was effective this academic year, in which New York residents can go to, can apply to college, go free tuition, but they have to sign a contract, which I think they have to remain 4 years after they graduate from their undergrad. They have to remain in the state of New York. I know I'm part of my faculty union, and I know that we have a committee, a legislator committee that meets with the state legislators. And I just learned this last week that they're now talking about doing the same thing in Vermont. And they were saying, it's not gonna be the first year, it's not gonna be effective, but you have to start talking about it so that maybe by 3 to 4 years, it can actually become a reality. But those are the kinds of connections that people, in terms of policy. And I know that Gloria and I talked about, we want to send copies of this book to people that we know are in positions that can make policy, or at least, hey, this is what really happens. Because again, I quoted some statistics, or 39%, 40 whatever, but what does that mean? Who are those people? And what this book is telling you, this anthology, these testimonials are telling you, is these are examples of people who actually, this is what they were able to do, and this is how they're paying back. So why wouldn't we want to invest more money and keep the policies that allow these people to contribute, to be able to make the contributions that they're making today? That's the spirit that guided us when we talked about doing this anthology. Any other questions? Share with this, but there is a lot of big money inserting its influence on curriculums, university curriculums. The Koch brothers are offering these grants where you have to sign up contracts, and they have to approve of what you're able to publish and guide a curriculum. This is happening. George Washington University, there's a group of students who are suing them. But what I'm trying, there is another big problem of what's going on in higher education. The way how this conservative big money is trying to influence those people who, of course, are not going to see the value in educating people like us. But yeah, it's a very complex.
I mean, yeah. I have really respect them for work, because it's needed to be out there to refer to, you know, and give more people, ammunition or things to draw on.
Thank you very much.
Thank you so much.
Thank you for being here.